Jesus, for allowing us to be here today, Lord. Praise God. There's some places in the world where people can't do what we're doing this morning. Have the freedom to gather in Jesus' name and worship Him without fear of being raided or man. Praise God. There's a lot going on in our country that could try to hinder that. Amen. But we're here today, thankfully, to be able to be here in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. God is good. Brother Dingman reminded me that today at 3 o'clock would be the Jewish time whenever Jesus would have been crucified at 3,
yes.
Under according to the
that's
lunar.
He healed up the ghost at 3 o'clock.
What's that?
At 3 o'clock, 9th hour, he would die.
Yeah, the 9th hour, which would be 3 o'clock. Amen. We celebrate Resurrection Sunday this next weekend, but if if you were to go by the lunar, it would be today that would be the crucifixion. Amen. So we give thanks to the Lord for His death. Amen. Praise God. Without His death, we would have no life. Praise God. Just think of the many, many souls that that the Lord has affected by what He's done at Calvary. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Our hearts should be filled with gratitude. And I am filled with gratitude to the Lord.
Yes.
For what He has done. Praise God. Well, God is good. We're going to turn in our Bibles this morning as we have this time of Bible study prior to going into worship. We're going to turn into the book of Revelation, chapter 13. I'm going to read one verse of scripture, and then we will pray. Praise God. Now, I have used this scripture in the last little while, at different times, in speaking about the end time, because I do believe very much that we are living in the end time.
Yeah.
Praise God. And so I feel that it is important for me as a pastor to keep you attentive to what's going on in our world.
Yeah.
Amen. And I just hope to spur some thought in you and maybe something to be said to, I hope you're already close to the Lord, but to help you to persevere in your walk with God.
Yeah.
And get close to Him, stay close to Him. Praise God. He is coming again. And we do not know the exact day or hour,
right.
But we are personally responsible,
yeah,
for being ready at the second coming of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. So we're going to look at Revelation 13:1. It says, "And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy." Praise God. So if you'll join me in prayer, we'll say a prayer right quick. Amen. Ask the Lord to touch us. Praise God. Lord Jesus, God, I thank you for being here. We acknowledge your presence this morning. God, we believe that you hear us as we pray. Great God, and Lord, not only do you hear prayer, but you answer prayer. And we ask you today to touch us today by the word of the Lord. Let something be said here today that's going to help those that are listening, whether they're in this congregation or by way of Facebook or whatever way that you, that this word is, comes to them. I pray that you would touch us and help us to walk with you and to be ready at your second coming. I ask for grace this morning, God, to minister your word in Jesus' name. Amen. And let everybody say in Jesus' name. Praise God. You know, I think that even a lot of people that are not believers, I believe that they realize that something's going on in our world, worldwide. Even before the pandemic came our way, people were stirred up. I remember reading one article, I can't even remember where it was, but it was not a Christian article. It was just a secular article, and the person writing it said, the world is on fire.
Yeah.
Yeah. They realize that things are transpiring in the day and hour that we live in. Amen. We as Christians that have read the Bible, studied the Bible, believe the Bible, we really have our antennas up, our spiritual antennas. And we see things going on that we believe the Bible has spoken of and informed us about that would be going on during the end time.
Yeah.
And I believe that we're living in the end time. And I in believing it, I believe that we need to stay awake. You know, Jesus said for us that we were not to sleep as others do. Amen? Spiritually speaking. Another place, Jesus said, watch and pray, for you know not when the hour is. But other scriptures tell us that we can know that it's near, even at the door, when we see certain things. Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews said, you know, that we were not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together, and so much the more, as you see the day approach. So, there are, a Christian should be able to, through reading the Word of God, should be able to know that it's near.
Yes.
When you see the fig tree bloom, know that it's near, Jesus said. You know, summer's near. Amen. Those are signs that tell you things are happening. Praise God. Amen. I've got, it's springtime right now in Texas. You know, and there are wild plum trees out in the pasture behind my neighbor's house, and those things are pretty purple, and they're just beautiful looking, but they're blooming out.
Yeah.
And those are signs that the sap is rising because the season is changing.
Right.
Amen. And so Jesus used illustrations like that to help us to understand that we, when the time would be, even though we don't know the day nor the hour, and we can know that it's near. And he told us that at, during that time, we need to look up, for our redemption draws near. And the, and that redemption is talking about the redemption of our bodies.
Amen.
The redemption of our bodies. Right. When the dead in Christ shall rise, and those that are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord, they're going to be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air.
Right.
And they're going to forever be with the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
That's what he's talking about. Lift up your head. What is he? He's not talking about just going up, going outside and looking up in the sky. He's not talking about that.
Right.
I believe he's talking about get your eyes and your attention off of today.
Yeah,
absolutely. Off this world. and get it on what your heart and your mind, all your focus should be on the second coming of Jesus. Amen. Because it draws near. And I know there's things that we've got to do in life and take care of business, and the Lord expects us to do those things. But we've got to keep it in its right balance and place. The number one thing we need to do is be living for the Lord and trying to reach souls, trying to reach lives. Amen. Trying to help other people to be ready to meet the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Have peace with God. So let me read the scripture one more time again, just to refresh what we've read. I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. This beast that's rising up out of the sea is spoken of several times in different places in Scripture. But it's referencing an end time one world government.
Right.
That's what it's talking about. The Bible tells us that there's going to come a one world government. Amen.
Yes.
And it's going to happen right at the end. You can look at Daniel chapter 2, the image Nebuchadnezzar saw. Daniel chapter 7 talks about it. The book of Revelation talks about it several places in there. Chapter 13, chapter 17, it speaks about this one world power that's going to arise. It's going to have seven heads, ten horns, and upon his head the name of blasphemy. And I believe that we currently are seeing this. We're seeing this thing try to take hold right now in our world, and the United States even.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise God. One of the things, I read something the other day. I was on the internet. I like to get on there and read news articles and stuff and see things that's happening. I am sometimes interested in looking at the political stuff and see what's going on and things. Praise God. But this article right here was in there. And I'm going to read it to you. Praise God. This just kind of affirms what I'm talking to you about today, that we are living with this thing trying to develop.
Yep.
And it has been for a while. I know it has.
Right.
But it's really coming to a head.
Yes.
And I'm not going to read all of it, but I highlighted a few things. Praise God. This article was published. I got two articles. I'm going to read them both. But this first one was published by Art Moore. It was published March the 15th, 2021 at 7:56 p.m. So it was just recently, within the past little over a week. Okay? It was published. And this article, the heading of it, is Pope Calls for New World Order After Coronavirus Pandemic. Yeah. Did anybody else read that? Nobody else? Pope Calls for New World Order After Coronavirus Pandemic. It's time to remove social injustice and marginalization, aligning with the call amongst globalist leaders for a great reset in response to the corona pandemic. Pope Francis makes the case for a new world order in a book to be published Tuesday. That world, he explains, in God and the world to come, is characterized by the shift from financial speculation, fossil fuels, and military buildup to a green economy based on inclusiveness. The book is a lengthy question and answer with Italian journalist Domenico Agasso. I don't know if I said his name right. After the coronavirus pandemic, he said in an excerpt of the book released by the Vatican, "No one today can afford to rest easy. The world will never be the same again, but it is precisely within this calamity that we must grasp those signs which may prove to be the cornerstone of reconstruction," he said. Listen to this part right here. "Let us all keep in mind that there is something worse than this crisis," referencing the pandemic. He tells what it is. He says, "The drama to waste it." The drama to waste it. Yeah. Francis stated. Praise God. Francis called an end to short-sighted nationalism and other forms of political selfishness. In his third encyclical in 2020, the Pope declared the coronavirus pandemic proves that the magic theories of market capitalism have failed, and the world needs new systems that promote equality and unity. He opposes a right to property for individuals. You know what he's talking about there? That's the same thing as communism.
Yeah. Right.
He opposes a right to property for individuals, contending a social purpose and common good must come from sharing the earth's resources. Amen. That's that first article. Here's the next article. This is published October the 9th, 2020 in Natural News. Pope Francis says, "New World Order needs to happen now." With the United Nations in charge, praise God. In his latest encyclical letter, Pope Francis issues a plea for the nations of the world to hand their reins of power over to the United Nations, which Francis says will lead us all into the new world order.
There you go. Right.
Time is ripe to cement into place a system of global governance that can never be undone, Francis contends. And he goes on to say, given this situation, it is essential to devise stronger and more efficiently organize international institutions and functionaries who are appointed fairly by agreement among national governments and empowered to impose sanctions, he writes.
Yeah.
Sanctions like, you can't buy or sell,
right.
Huh? Except you receive the mark of the beast or the number of his name. That's what scripture says that's going to happen. Amen. Listen to what he says. Praise God. Francis says this: nations need legal limits to prevent them from becoming too powerful individually. The only way to give the UN the teeth that Francis thinks it needs in order to rule the world is to place clear legal limits on all individual nations, meaning stripping of their sovereignty.
Yeah. Yeah.
Francis believes that multilateral rather than bilateral agreements will best serve this end, creating a new system of global governance controlled by one single entity.
Right.
I'm just telling you what. He has it in his encyclicals. Recently, he wants there to be one global entity, one global power. And he's pushing for it. In fact, the book of Revelation, the second beast that is mentioned on down, I haven't got there in scripture, I just read the one scripture, but the second beast is supposed to do miracles, signs, and wonders to persuade men to worship the beast and to get convince people of the beast. Well, this right here says the Pope's encouraging the one world government.
Yes, sir.
And there needs to be one legal system and one entity that all men look to. That's what I read in my Bible, folks. I said, that's what I read in my Bible.
Yes.
Praise God. That's going to happen in the end time. So he says, I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns, ten crowns, and upon his names, the names of blasphemy. I want to keep that. Can you keep that scripture up there, Brother Dean? Just for a little bit. We're going to look at some other scriptures. First of all, amen. The Pope Francis basically spoke and said he was against personal, owning personal property.
Yes.
That's what I read it and understood it to say.
That's right.
That's the same thing communism does.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
And socialism is basically the beginning of communism. That's what it is.
Right. Right.
Amen. It is the, I used, last time I spoke about this, you know, they say marijuana is a entrance drug, I believe it is. What do they call it?
Gateway.
Huh?
To
a gateway. Gateway drug.
Yep.
To other drugs.
Yes.
Right? That's basically what socialism is. And our world just kicked out probably one of the biggest capitalists out of office, Donald Trump. He was for nationalism and America first. You know, I've heard it said. Whether you agree with that or not, I'm just telling you the facts. He stood up before the United Nations and said each nation needs to put their own nation first.
Right.
And he called it the big stink. But I didn't read it, but also Francis is pushing a world without borders.
Yeah, true.
That's in part of that article, too. I didn't read that part. A world without borders. And right now there is a big push in the United States of America for socialism.
Yes, sir. Right.
Socialism. Now, socialism, again, is the gateway to communism.
Uh-huh.
Amen? And if you look at those nations, take China, for instance. The color of their regime, their flags, their emblems and stuff, it's red. Amen?
Amen?
Here we see that there's a beast rising up out of the sea, this end-time government, what we're talking about, having seven heads and ten horns. If you turn to Revelation chapter 17, it gives us a little more insight to this beast. He sees a woman riding this beast. In Revelation 17:3, it says, so he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman. This is the religious aspect of this.
Right.
I saw a woman set upon a scarlet-colored beast,
yeah,
full of the name of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. Same beast.
Right.
This woman is setting upon this scarlet-colored beast. And I kind of stopped what I was saying a while ago, but back in Revelation 13, that second beast that's on down, a few scriptures we haven't read yet, that second beast is a false prophet. Amen? that's going to arise and convince the world to follow the first beast.
Right.
Amen. Praise God. This beast is called, is said to be scarlet colored. And if you look up the dictionary, you'll see where scarlet is a red color.
Right.
Amen. Well, it also, the book of Revelation chapter 12, verse 3, it also lets us know, amen, about the devil a little bit. Revelation 12 and 13, it says, and there appeared another wonder in heaven, a great what?
Red dragon.
Behold, a great red dragon. The dragon's red too. Amen. And what does this dragon have? He has seven heads and ten horns and seven crowns upon his heads. This is the same beast, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's the same beast. And again, the red is the color of the great dragon. Amen. Praise God. Is the Bible letting us know that the end time one world government that has seven heads and ten horns, that the woman is sitting upon, that it is going to be a communist structure, a socialist, communistic structure? I believe so. Amen. It tells us who the dragon is on down in Revelation chapter 12, verses 7 through 11. I want to read all of this because these are things that's going to happen in the future. Okay, things that we are actually embarking upon right now. These things are endeavoring to come together right now as we speak.
Yes,
amen. Revelation 12, 7 says, and there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. There's the dragon, the same dragon that was up at verse number 3 that had seven heads and ten horns and was red. There was war. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out. Listen to what he's termed as. That old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth. What's he going to do? He's going to deceive the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Amen. Praise God. So this dragon, this end time government, this system that's going to develop is of Satan.
Yeah.
It's of the devil, and it's going to deceive the whole world. That's what it says right there. He goes on down to say, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, verse 10, now has come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused him before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony. And they loved not their life unto the death. Amen. Praise God. I'm telling you something, folks. The things that's going to transpire in our world is going to take a people that are sold out to God.
Yeah.
I said it's going to take a people. Amen.
Amen.
That's going to overcome. We can overcome.
Yeah.
We're going to overcome by the blood of the Lamb,
amen,
by the word of our testimony, but we've got to be sold out to the point we love not our life unto the death. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. I believe pressure's coming. Amen. Pressure's here. It's intensifying. It's intensifying in America today upon Christians.
Yeah.
Amen. There's people that have gotten locked up over this pandemic thing.
Yes, sir.
Because they keep having church.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. And there are people that have gained positions of power in our country that hate Christianity.
Amen.
And they are trying hard to turn this country against Christianity.
Yes.
I'm telling you, there's pressure on them. Amen. Praise God. Amen. There's people in our world right now, and have been for a long time, that are already facing pressure.
Yeah.
In many places of the world, Christianity is the most persecuted religion that there is.
Sure.
People are giving their lives, and if you read the book of Revelation, there's coming a time where people are going to be beheaded for the name of Jesus. Guess what? It's already been happening for quite some time in the day and hour that we live in today. Praise God. Amen. In these past years in America, it's been pretty easy to come to church and enjoy worshiping the Lord with freedom. Amen. Nobody persecuting you. Amen.
Amen.
The worst persecution most of us have met in America, with the exception of a few, is verbally. Criticism or something like that. It may not always be that easy.
That's right.
I said it may not always be that easy. Amen. Praise God. And we're going to have a walk with God, folks. Praise God. I'm not just trying to sound negative, but I'm telling you, this stuff is developing right now. Amen. I believe it's developing right now. Praise God. Daniel mentions this beast that will form in the end time. All the way back, even before Jesus ever came, the prophet Daniel spoke of this that was going to arise at the end. Of time, up at the end, right at this, before the second coming of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Oh, praise God. I'm telling you, not only is this evil empire coming, Jesus Christ is going to come. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Daniel mentions it in Daniel 7, verses 7 and 8. After this, I saw in a night vision, behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It had iron teeth. Amen. Praise God. Amen. If you look in Daniel chapter 2, I'm not going to go there right at the very moment. I'll get there in just a few moments. But in Daniel 2, it talks about this same image with the iron. Amen. But this beast that's going to arise in it has great iron teeth. Reflection on the Roman Empire.
Right.
Amen. That's where the iron comes from. We'll talk about that here in a little bit. It goes on to say, it says, it devoured and broke in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it. And it had 10 horns. There it is again. That ten-horned beast. Amen. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn. This is the Antichrist. There's going to be a man. The Roman Empire had emperors. Okay? Those emperors were worshipped. Okay? They were Caesars. They were called Caesars. Amen. And they were worshipped as gods.
Absolutely.
There was a religious aspect to it, to those kingdoms, okay? This is somewhat of a figure of what's going to be taking place in the end. And this horn, this little horn, is going to be that, like that emperor. Amen. Praise God. We know it, this man as the Antichrist. Amen. There's going to be an Antichrist, and there's going to be a false prophet.
Right.
And I believe I just got through reading about the false prophet. Praise God. That's where the iron comes in. The Roman Empire was defeated early on, but the way that it continued is through the Roman Catholic Church, folks. Amen. The Caesars were called the Pontiff Maximus. And the popes took that inscription upon themselves. Amen. Amen. You can study all that. But he goes on to say, I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, by whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. Paul also spoke about this man in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, which I'm not going to go there right now. So let's look at Daniel chapter 2 in verse number 32. Nebuchadnezzar, which was a heathen king, the king of Babylon, he had a dream. And we know, you read the whole story, Daniel was brought before him, and Daniel interpreted the dream. And this is what it says in verse 32. The image's head was of fine gold. And Daniel told the king Nebuchadnezzar that he was that head of gold. His breast and arms of silver. This was the Medo-Persian Empire that even the book of Daniel bears out, that arose after the Babylonian Empire with Darius and Cyrus. Amen. Praise God. The next one was, that was mentioned here, his belly and his thighs were of brass. Amen. That's the Grecian Empire with Alexander the Great conquering the known world at that time. And the next one is, he says, and his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. Amen. The legs being of iron speaks of the time whenever Jesus walked the earth with the Roman Empire. Amen. Praise God. Amen. And it's going to have an iron influence all the way to the feet. Amen. If you look at Daniel chapter 2, verse 42, as Daniel's interpreting this image, he says, and as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom, we're talking about that end time kingdom, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. Notice here, the feet, how many toes you got on your feet? You got five on one of your feet. I'm talking about all together. Five and five is ten. How many kings are supposed to be in this end time when we're government? Ten. Amen? It's during the time of these feet and toes being a part iron and part clay that there's going to come a stone cut out of a mountain made without hands, and it's going to smite the image on the feet. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. And it's going to completely obliterate that image. All of the kingdoms. Amen. The it's going to grind them to powder, and the wind's going to carry them away. Amen. You can read it in Daniel chapter 2. Amen. Praise God. That stone that smote the image on the feet is the second coming of Jesus with judgment. Amen. Upon the world of wickedness. Amen. He's going to smite the image on the feet. What I'm trying to tell you this morning is we have right now before our eyes things trying to develop that's going to bring that one world government into existence. Amen. It's going to take and it's going to be exceeding powerful, it said in Daniel. Amen. It's going to stomp the residue with its feet. Amen. Praise God. There's the feet again. It's going to stomp the residue. All that resists, it's going to stomp. Amen. Praise God. But the Lord is going to come back during the days of these kings. And he is that stone that comes out of heaven. He's going to smite that image on the feet. That's the second coming of Jesus at the Battle of Armageddon. And I want you to know something. There's not going to be another kingdom when Jesus comes back again. Amen? The Lord's going to be the king over all the earth. There's going to be one Lord, and his name's going to be one. But listen to me, folks. We need to be close to God. We need to be living for God. We need to have a prayer life. And we need to have God in his rightful place in our lives, because between now and the second coming of Jesus, there's lots of things going to happen and transpire.
Amen.
Yeah.
There's lots of things going to happen. Praise God. And what time the Lord is going to actually take the church out of here, I cannot definitely tell you. I will give you my ideal, and you're not probably going to like it. But it's probably going to be in the arena of Armageddon. In that time area. And you might say, well, that means the church is going to be here when the Antichrist is here. Well, I hope not, but,
yes,
you know, I think the scriptures bear it out. Amen. I think the scriptures bear it out. If you read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, starting with verse number 1, I didn't pull that scripture up. Praise God. Maybe Brother Demon can pull it up for us right quick. Praise God here. We'll read it on the backboard. I mean on the board back here. Paul's writing to the Christians. Okay? He's writing to the Christians of Thessalonica. And he tells them, he says, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." That word "by the coming" is talking about concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Look it up. That's what it means. "And our gathering together unto him." In 1 Thessalonians, Paul instructed the Thessalonians about the coming of the Lord. He said, "The trumpet's going to sound, and the dead are going to be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed." He said that in 1 Corinthians 15. But in 1 Thessalonians, he also mentioned that we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. And the next chapter, you got to remember, the scriptures originally don't have no chapters.
Right.
So the topic is continued on in chapter 5, and it says, "You have no need that I write unto you, but as the day of the Lord's coming as a thief in the night."
Right.
In other words, when that day comes that the previous chapter spoke about,
right,
that catching away. You know, he went on to say, we're not in darkness that day should overtake us, the Christians,
right,
as a thief. We're all children of the day, not of the night. Amen. Right. We are not appointed unto wrath, he went on to say. He's talking about the wrath of God. Christians are not appointed to the wrath of God. But that does not mean that we won't go through things during this time of tribulation.
Right.
The wrath of God and the Antichrist are not the same thing. The Lord is going to allow, according to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, the Lord is going to allow the Antichrist to come on the scene because people love wickedness.
Yes.
People love evil. For this cause, God will send them strong delusion that they will believe a lie, talking about the Antichrist. All those who receive not the love of the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. This man is going to be allowed to come on the scene to deceive those that don't love God.
Right.
Amen. But there are going to be people here on the earth that's going to be persecuted for the name of Jesus and for the word of God. They're even going to be beheaded in some places. They're going to be persecuted in some places. Amen. Praise God. Now I hope that there is a pre-tribulation, a pre-rapture. I would love that. But I'm just being honest with you. What I see in the scriptures, listen, because look at what we're reading here.
Right.
He said, back it up one verse, back it up again, if you would, Brother Dean. Paul says, "Now beseech you, brethren, by or concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him." That's being caught up in the air, the gathering together unto him. That's the only gathering together unto him that is mentioned in the Bible. And there's not two raptures.
Right.
Praise God.
Amen.
Now go to the next verse. That you be, he said, "Be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter asked from us, that the day of Christ is at hand." Let me tell you what this is saying. This is saying the same thing that Jesus said. Jesus said, if they say the Christ is in the desert, don't go after him.
Right.
If they say he's in the secret chamber, don't go after him. Don't be shaken by anything that's going to transpire in the world. Christians, right?
Yeah.
He said, okay, the next verse says, "Let no man deceive you by any means." That's what I was saying. "That for that day shall not come." That day, what day? Our gathering together unto him. The coming of the Lord, our gathering together in him. "That day shall not come except there come a falling away first."
Right.
An apostasy.
Right.
Falling away from the truth.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Except there come a falling away first. And what? "And that man of sin be revealed. The son of perdition." That's the Antichrist. What's that saying? It's saying that the second coming of Jesus is not going to take place until That man of sin has been revealed. That's, and our gathering together unto Jesus in the air is not going to happen until there comes a falling away and that man of sin be revealed. Is that what that says?
Amen.
I don't want it to say that, but I think that's what it says. Amen. Praise God. Go ahead and let's read some more while we're talking on this topic. This is what this man of sin is going to do. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Daniel also spoke about this man.
Yeah.
Okay, keep going on, Brother Demon. Thank you. Remember you not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. What is it else? Go ahead. And you know what withholdeth that he might be revealed in his time. This man of sin is going to be revealed in this time. There's a time when the Lord's going to allow him to come on the scene. Okay? For the mystery, something that not everybody sees, just like the mystery of godliness, that Jesus was God manifested in the flesh, not everybody sees that. Some people want to make a trinity out of him.
Come on.
But he wasn't a trinity. He's the one and true God, the only God that there is, come in human form. Manifest in flesh to die for our sins. The mystery of iniquity, though, is this man coming on the scene. The mystery of iniquity does already work. Only he who now letteth, the word letteth talks about hindering. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And a lot of people preach that this is the church. But if it's the church, and I hope it is, but if it's the church, why did it say that the coming, the second coming of the Lord and our gathering together unto him won't happen until the man of sin is revealed?
Right.
Why would it contradict itself? It's not contradicting itself. There's something hindering. Amen. And that something that's hindering is God is not letting that man come on the scene until the time is right.
Right. Amen.
Amen. There's powers that be that exist until the second coming, whenever Jesus gets ready for this man of sin to be revealed. And listen to me, I believe it, I believe it, I believe it. We see it transpiring before our very eyes. Wake up, everybody.
Amen.
Wake up. Everybody, wake up. Get on fire for God. Live for God.
Yes.
Yes, look for him today. You know, there is that certain aspect of the mystery when Jesus is coming again that we don't know the day nor the hour.
That's right.
And we may actually be further along than we even realize here today.
Amen.
There's a lot of things behind the scenes that we don't even see.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Praise God. The mystery of iniquity is all work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. That's that stone coming out of heaven in Daniel 2. Smiting the image on the feet.
Amen.
Listen there, here's another point. He's going to smite him on the feet during the days of the 10 toes. In the feet, part of iron and part of clay. That's where the Lord's going to smite it at.
Yeah.
That has to be there. If the church gets out before there's any feet and toes,
right,
and the stone coming out and smiting on the feet is the Lord coming,
right,
those things got to be in existence for them to be smitten on the feet.
Amen.
By the stone, what I'm saying. Those things have got to transpire. They're going to transpire. And they're trying to happen right now.
Yes, right.
I just got through reading. They're calling for a one world government. They're calling. Right, I just read you the articles. Amen. And the man that probably will be the false prophet is the one I'm reading about.
Right.
Yeah. If it's not him, it's going to be the one at that time. And you got to remember that Roman influence is going to be there. That iron.
Yes.
It's going to be part iron and part clay. Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
And then, when he who hinders is taken out of the way, then shall that wicked be revealed whom the Lord is going to consume with the spirit of his mouth and destroy at the brightness of his coming. That man's going to be walking the earth when Jesus comes and smites him.
Yeah.
There's not two second comings of Jesus, folks.
That's true.
Right.
There's only one second coming of Jesus.
Amen.
You know? And this man's going to get hammered.
Yeah.
By the second coming of Jesus. He's going to get hammered. And all that beast. He's the mouthpiece of the beast.
Right.
And the false prophet is the one that's showing the great signs and the wonders, according to Revelation 13. He's that second beast. He's going to convince, persuade the world to follow this man.
Right.
Amen. And take his mark and worship his image. They're going to put sanctions on people that don't follow it. They're not going to be able to buy or sell.
That's right.
And that's what we just got through reading. Amen. This Pope is pushing. Amen. For a one world entity with the only rules that there are. We also read where the Antichrist is going to change times and laws.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's going to set his own rules and he's going to demand that the world follow it. Amen. Praise God. And he's going to put sanctions on people that won't follow. They're not going to be able to buy or sell except they have the mark of the beast or the number of the beast, the number of his name in their right hand or forehead. Amen. Amen. We're living at a time, folks, where all this stuff can transpire. Amen. That's where we are. And you know what? We see it developing right now.
Amen.
Again, it's probably farther than we even can understand. This beast, this end time beast, seven heads and ten horns, right? And upon it, it's going to have ten crowns. Praise God. Let's look at the ten kings right quick. In Daniel chapter 7, verse 23. Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon the earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down and break it in pieces. The ten horns out of this kingdom are ten kings that shall arise. And another shall arise after them. We read this. But there's going to be ten kings that arise. Praise God. Amen. I'm going to try to. Let me see. I got to get my notes. I got off my notes for a while. Praise God. Revelation 17, 12 through 14. Let me just read a few of the verses. It says, and the ten horns which thou sawest are ten kings which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. That's got to be us, folks. We got to be called, chosen, and faithful. We've been called, we've been chosen, but our part's to be faithful. Huh? Praise God. This right here says that those ten kings, they haven't received a kingdom as yet. In other words, it's much like the United Nations.
Yes.
Amen. They're going to have one mind. They're going to, in other words, they're going to be like a council of kings that's with the Antichrist is going to rule the world. Mm-hmm. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. I'm trying to follow my notes. Bear with me. Praise God. In Daniel chapter 2, verse 44, the Daniel's image again. And in the days of these kings, the kings he's talking about, the ten toes. Okay? In the day when the image is smitten on the feet, that part iron, part clay. In the days of these kings, everybody say, in the days of these kings.
Amen.
They're existing, aren't they?
Amen.
They're in existence. In the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Amen. Amen. We are living in troublesome times, but we're involved in something in the kingdom of God that's going to be eternal. It's going to last forever. Amen?
Amen?
Praise God. That's why Jesus said when he was talking about the end time, he that endures to the end the same shall be saved. Praise God. Amen. He that endures to the end. You know, enduring something, it must be somewhat difficult. It's not too difficult, you know, to go down to Cotton Cafe in Rogers, Texas, and get you one of them homemade bluebell vanilla ice cream floats. It's not a whole lot of enduring and lapping that up. Amen. That is some kind of good eating. Amen. I haven't endured anything whenever I am enjoying that ice cream float. You can tell I probably had a few of them. Or the likes. They got a whole lot of other good things in there. I'm not trying to make promotions for my daughter's cafe, but I am saying this is awfully good.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. I went down there. My wife went to ladies' retreat. I went down there, I think, was it Saturday?
Friday.
I went down there Friday. Oh, yeah, it was Friday. Because they got all you can eat. Or not all you can eat, can't eat. But it is all you can eat. A couple of times when I went in there, I had a little piece. But I ate catfish. And I'll tell you what, they got the best catfish, fried catfish dinner. It, you know, a lot of times when I eat catfish stuff, it's kind of some murky, some what of a taste. But not that catfish. That catfish, every time I've ate it three or four times in there, every time I've ate it, I open it up and it's just white as can be inside.
Right.
Clean. Clean. Must be farm-raised catfish and stuff. But, I mean, I didn't endure nothing by having to eat that. The only thing I had to endure is got a little too full, probably. You know, had to put up with that. But as far as feasting on that catfish, that was really some good catfish.
Man.
Amen. Hush puppies. I don't really normally like hush puppies. Man, those are good. There wasn't no enduring. There wasn't no putting up with that, enduring that. That was plum pleasure. Amen. But Jesus said concerning the end time, he that endureth to the end, the same shall be saved. Amen. There's a lot of people going to cave and give in to things coming. I don't want to cave.
Yeah.
I want to have the walking with God. I want to have a walk with God.
Yes.
I want to help other people to have a walk with God.
Amen.
I'm trying to encourage you today to have a walk with God.
Amen.
Amen. I'm telling you, like we've already mentioned already this morning, lift, when you see these things become the past, lift up your heads. Get your attention off of today. Get your attention on things above, not on things on the earth. Because your redemption draws near. The redemption is the redemption of our body, the catching away.
Amen.
You study those, you read those things. Folks, there's some difficult times coming in our world. And whether you're a Christian or not, there's going to be difficult times happening. You better stick with the Master. And hang in there with the Master. We've got to make it to the other side. You hear me? We've got to make it to the other side. No matter what comes, no matter what goes, we got to make it to the other side.
Right.
And we can only make it safely to the other side through Jesus.
Amen.
We have. In having Jesus in our life, we have what it takes to get to the other side.
Sure.
Don't let any man take your crown. You hear me?
Yes.
Don't let anything take your crown. Amen. Hang on to the Lord. My time is up. Praise God. Take an opportunity while we change the order of the service. Take an opportunity if you need to go to the restroom. Get your drink.
I want to thank all our Facebook family that are watching. We're going to start off with prayer. Thank you, Lord God, for all that you've done. Thank you for your goodness and grace, Lord God. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to be in your house. Lord God, we thank you, Lord. We give you praise.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thanks, Lord.
John Frizzell, Brother Frizzell's father, Sister Demon.
Please pray up. I have a friend at work. She just found out she's tattooed with the ladies, and she's having a real hard time getting medication, you know, that doesn't have bad side effects or whatever. And also pray for my mom and my sister.
Okay. Brother Dingle.
Please don't forget Brother Schwartz down in Venezuela. Issues going on down there affecting our people.
Amen.
And also remember Kenya, they're all doing on lockdown, so you have good believers over there as well.
Amen. Brother Brendan, let's remember Michael Jeffrey. Amen. Let's remember the Tamez family. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Jesus, God, we thank you, Lord, for everything that you're doing. We thank you for your goodness today, oh God. Heavenly Father, Lord, I worship you. Jesus, you're worthy of all the praise. God, we pray for Sister Krennic today and Lewis, Lord. God, we pray, Jesus, for you to move, God, in their lives. Do what needs to be done. Heal their bodies, Lord. God, save their souls. God, touch Sister Cooper. God Almighty, touch Lynn Mills, God, I pray for you, for healing virtue to flow through these. God, touch Patricia, God, and John. Frizzell, Lord, I pray, Lord, for you to work, God. Lord, heal their bodies. God, give them strength in their bodies and in their spirits, oh God. Lord, do what needs to be done, we pray. Touch the Tamez family, God. God Almighty, Lord, I pray for you to work in these lives. God, touch Michael Jeffrey, Lord. God, I pray for you to make yourself known unto him. God, touch these around the world that are affected. God, the Swartz family and the churches in Venezuela and in Kenya, God, and all around the world, God, we pray, God, for these believers, God. God, for you to be with them, Lord. Touch this woman that Sister Damon works with. God, have your way, oh Lord. Jesus, Lord, we thank you for your goodness. And we love you today, Lord. In Jesus' name, we praise you for it. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Jesus. Everybody say, in Jesus' name. Lord, let it be done today. Hallelujah, Jesus. We worship you. Yes, God. We pray for you today. God, we magnify your name, oh Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Hallelujah.
Sure.
thankful today that we can talk to him.
Amen.
I'm thankful that we serve a God that listens to us.
Yes.
And that responds to us.
Yes, he does.
Hallelujah. Amen. I don't know if you feel alone this morning, but you're not alone. Amen. God is here. God is moving. God is desiring to work in your life.
Yes.
Amen. Reach out to him this morning.
Unstoppable, that's who you are. You're
Children of Israel, stop God from working. Amen. And the word of the Lord came unto Moses and said, these Philistines that you see today, you shall see them no more forever. Right. In other words, he's saying, I'm going to take care of this problem once and for all. Amen. And I feel like in the Holy Ghost today that is what the Lord is wanting to do today.
Amen.
Amen. These things that have been trailing you for so long, he's saying, I want to take care of it once and for all. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm glad I serve that kind of God. Amen. Praise God. We're going to ask for ushers to come this morning. And as they are coming, Sister Emily has some announcements that she needs to make.
I have a few announcements, so if you will bear with me for just a moment. Okay, so Mother's Memorial, I announced it a couple of Sundays ago now, I believe. It started March 1st. It's going to end July 1st. So whatever you choose to give, we need to have it in. So you've got a few months, but we'll need to have it in by the end of June. There are some pledge cards out front. It's not perforated in the middle, but you can tear it off because one is a part for you to keep and the other is a part for you to turn in. What we had mentioned doing was giving whatever the amount of your mom's birth month and birth date is combined. So example, my mom's birthday is December 2nd, so I would give $14, 12 and 2. And that's something everyone can give to, not just the ladies. It supports many different ministries for the UPCI. Also, this coming Saturday, April the 3rd, we're going to have a church cleaning day up here. The men will probably be up here, you mentioned 8 o'clock. I'm planning to be here about 9 till noon. Just to kind of get everything spruced up, cleaned up real good, because next Sunday is Easter or Resurrection Sunday. So we're planning on having a lot of visitors. So we want the church to look really nice and welcoming. And then Saturday, April the 3rd, that evening at 6 o'clock, we're going to be having a worship team practice. Also, Easter's big Sunday. Sister Rachel is putting together an event for the children for Easter next Sunday, and we need everyone to bring at least one nice size bag of candy. Please make sure the candy is individually wrapped inside. So, because if it lands on the ground or whatever, then kids won't get to eat it. So just make sure the candy is individually wrapped. And please make sure you have that here. Is it okay if they get here by next Sunday morning? By Sunday, or do you want it?
By Saturday.
By Saturday? Okay, if you can, please get the candy here by Saturday. So Sister Rachel has that. Then, the following weekend, we are going to be in revival with Brother Shane Brixner. And we're going to be serving a luncheon after the Sunday morning service. So that's on the 11th. So you can go ahead and be thinking about what you want to bring as far as a food item, dessert, whatever you'd like to bring. And then please let me know. And then Saturday, we have a lot going on, but that's okay. Saturday, April 17th, we are going to be having a youth bake sale at the Belton Feed. We have had to cancel our first two of the year for different reasons, but we want our kids to be able to go to Peak and other events, so please be thinking about what you want to bake for that, because we are going to need help with that, and we're going to try to make sure we have our bake sales going forward, because in order for us to raise the money that we need, we've got to have them. And then, of course, towards the end of the month, we'll be having Men's Fellowship. And Texas Men's Conference is at the end of this month. Thursday, the 29th through Saturday, May 1st. Registration is going to be $65 per person at the door. If you have questions about that, you can see Brother John. So we have a lot going on. But like I said before, a lot going on is signs of an active church. And an active church is a living church. And that's what people need, is a church that is alive. Amen. So are y'all glad to be in church this morning?
Yes.
I know it's a slim crowd, but that's okay.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Praise God.
Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness today. Lord, I pray, Jesus, for you to bless this tithe and offering as it's given unto you in Jesus' name. Amen. Give us unto the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. I would like to say that we had an excellent men's fellowship last night. And Brother Roland did an amazing job making the vittles. And Brother Leonard did a great job bringing the word. So we are looking forward to that. And I did not tell Emily this, but so I will be letting everybody know all together. Our men's fellowship for next month, we're not going to have one for March, okay? Because we have the end of March.
April.
Hallelujah. Yeah, amen.
April,
because we're going to be going, we're going to be at men's conference that weekend.
Right.
And we're going to get fired up and bring it back. And for those that are unable to go, we will, every year we buy the DVDs or the MP4s. And so I will get that to you if you're unable to go. But if you can go, try to go. We want you. If you're a man,
Amen.
I heard Brother Crawford Coon call it, all you hairy-legged men. You're a hairy-legged man, you go to men's conference. Amen.
I'm hairy-legged.
13 years and up is the age limit. And so we're excited about that. That's going to be a great time. Amen. Praise God. Are you glad to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Joshua chapter number 10. Joshua chapter number 10. Joshua chapter number 10. Amen. All my young ministers in the young ministers class needs to be standing. Needs to be standing with the word in their hand. Brother Nick. Let's stand. Amen. Let's get the word of God in our hand. Amen. Very good. Or share with Brother Danny. Amen. Joshua chapter number 10, verse number 24. Joshua 10 and verse number 24. And it came to pass when they brought out those kings unto Joshua. And Joshua called for all the men of Israel and said unto the captains of the men of war which went with him, come near, put your feet upon the necks of these kings. And they came near and put their feet upon the necks of them. And Joshua said unto them, fear not, nor be dismayed. Be strong and of a good courage. For thus shalt the Lord do to all your enemies against whom ye fight. Deuteronomy chapter number 2 and verse number 24. Deuteronomy chapter number 2, verse number 24. Rise ye up, take your journey, and pass over the river Arnon. Behold, I have given into thine hand Sihon, the Amorite king of Heshbon and his land. Begin to possess it and contend with him in battle. We could read that very same verse in the Basic Bible English translation. And it says, get up now. Go on your journey, crossing over the valley of Arnon. See, I have given into your hand Sihon the Amorite, king of Heshbon, and all his land. Go forward and make it yours. Make war on him. Amen. Praise God. I want to preach to you a little bit this morning on when enough is enough. Amen. When enough, how many of you ever been fed up with something and you said, enough is enough?
Yeah.
I'm tired of being hounded by these issues. I'm tired of being hounded by these problems. Enough is enough. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. Thank you for your spirit. Jesus, I pray for you to help us, God, today, Lord. Help us, Lord Jesus. We need you, Lord. Help your word to go forth and find fertile ground that it may grow. In Jesus' name, amen. You can be seated. Praise God. Praise God. In Deuteronomy, the word of the Lord goes forward and says, go forward, make it yours, and make war on him. Amen. Make war on the enemy. Now, I don't know about you, but growing up, we have always thought and preached about the devil in a defensive kind of manner. Like we are trying to guard against the devil's attacks on us. The devil, you know, and I've heard it preached many, I've preached it many times, because the devil does attack you. The devil does do an offensive against you. But what I felt like in the Holy Ghost today is that there's got to be something that rises up within you that says enough is enough. I'm not going to put up with this anymore. And I am going to make war on the devil. Amen. I'm going to come against him. I'm going to war against him. I'm going to fight against him. I'm not going to just take whatever he throws at me. I'm not going to allow just anything that happens to happen. But I'm going to use the power and the authority of the Holy Ghost to make war on the enemy. Amen. Amen. Luke chapter 10, verse number 19. Behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. Notice that is an offensive action. The devil's not treading upon you. You're not guarding against what the devil is doing against you. But he said that the power that I give you is going to be an offensive power where you tread upon serpents and you tread upon scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. I mean, these verses tell us something, that you have to go after it. You have to engage the battle, the enemy in battle. Amen. The door to opportunity is marked with the
words push. Amen. God never promised you a life without battles. But he did promise you the victory if you would fight. Amen. If you would fight and you would do your part. And you would obey the word of the Lord. And you would fight against it. You would stand against the devil. And you would put on the armor of God. And you would make an, and you would do an onslaught and an offensive against the devil. The Lord says that he will provide a victory for you.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. My very first message that I ever preached behind a pulpit, I was 10 years old. And my father helped me craft that message, and we practiced it. And he told me, and I did it, but he told me, he said, John, you need to emphasize that I preached on Ephesians 6, on the armor of God, and how God has given us all this armor. But my father, he told me, and it was a point that stuck with me, and I emphasized it. He said, John, he said, the Lord never gave you armor for your backside. Amen. All the armor that you have that he has given you is covering your front. But he hasn't given any armor for your backside because he never intends for you to turn around and run.
That's right.
Amen. But to keep going forward,
amen,
to keep progressing, to keep fighting, to keep going and defeating the devil.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. It's amazing to me how many lazy people we have in the church today,
yeah,
who expect God to hand them everything on a silver platter.
Amen.
Even Jesus himself said, I will give you power over all the power of the enemy. Amen. Then he said that you must do the treading upon the serpents and the scorpions.
Right.
He says, I'm going to give you the power to overcome. But you've got to be willing to fight.
Right.
Amen. You've got to be willing to engage in battle. Amen. I feel in the Holy Ghost that the devil is attacking this church and attacking families and attacking marriages and trying to cause any sort of break in the harmony of the home. Amen. If he can destroy the home, if he can destroy that very centerpiece of the church. Amen. You know, home life is very important for the church.
Amen.
Amen. You have a house that is divided against itself, it's going to affect the church.
Right.
Amen. If you have a chaotic home life, it's going to affect the church.
Yeah.
It's going to affect your ministry. It's going to affect the kingdom of God.
Yeah.
And I want to warn you that the devil is attacking. But there's some of you just need to quit putting up with it and say, I'm not going another step in retreat, but I'm going to stand firm. I'm going to put on the armor of God, and I'm going,
amen,
to fight.
Amen.
I'm going to engage the enemy. I will make war on the enemy.
Yes.
Right. Yes. Amen. 2 Corinthians 10 tells us that we have weapons of warfare that are mighty, given to us by God. Amen. And with these weapons, we are called to pull down strongholds.
Right.
We are called to cast down imaginations and high arguments and theories that exalt themselves above the knowledge of God. And we bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ.
Right.
Amen. In our text, we read of Joshua saying to the captains who were representatives of the entire nation of Israel, you see these kings under your feet, God will give us this kind of victory over every enemy that we fight against.
Yeah,
amen. Again, we see that God has promised the victory, but it is dependent upon the action on your part.
Yeah.
Right.
Amen. You can't just come to church and just go through motions and expect to have victory with God. Amen. But in your personal life, you have got to build up a reinforcement of prayer, a reinforcement of fasting.
Amen.
A reinforcement of hiding the word of God in your heart, because that will help you to overcome the enemy.
Yes.
I'm reminded of the great walls that surrounded the city of Jericho. In Joshua chapter 6, God promised Joshua and the children of Israel that he would give them the city. But God did not make the walls fall flat by himself. He could have. But his action was always contingent upon ours.
Right.
He said, you got to march around the city. And you can't say a word. March around one time every day for 7 days. And on the seventh day, you march seven times. And on the seventh time that you march around, you lift your voice up and you cry out to the Lord. And you give a shout. Amen. And when that happened, those impenetrable walls came falling down.
Right.
Those walls that looked like they were too big. That problem that looked like it was too great. That you can't ever get victory from it. If you obey the word of the Lord and you allow your action to reflect that obedience to the word of God, amen, God will bring the victory in your life.
Amen.
God will bring it, those walls fall that seem like they will never fall. Amen. He will bring victory over that devil and those demons that have been afflicting you for so long if you will obey the word of the Lord. But you have got to get a mindset this morning that says, I'm tired of being beat up. I'm tired of being run over by the devil. I'm tired of being on the defensive. I'm going to go on the offensive. I'm going to engage the enemy. And I'm going to fight. And I'm going to allow God to bring about the victory.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I believe one of the greatest problems we have in the church today is that many of God's people are not properly trained and equipped to engage the enemy in battle. Amen. I say that not because they have not been told or taught, but because many today are unwilling to embrace the mindset and the attitude of a warrior. The majority of the church is very comfortable with the father-child relationship with God, meaning I'm his child, and he's supposed to take care of me. And that's absolutely true, and what a privilege it is to have that wonderful relationship with our Heavenly Father. But we're not talking about just waiting on Daddy, amen, to do everything and give us everything.
Amen.
But we're talking about the fact that there is a devil that hates you. And he's got a host of demons at his disposal who are absolutely set against the child of God. And he wants to destroy you. And we're talking about the fact that we're supposed to be walking in Jesus' footsteps, doing the same things that he did. Healing the sick, cleansing the lepers, casting out devils, preaching deliverance to the captives, and setting people free from the devil's power. That's what we're supposed to do. Amen. The Lord has done everything that he needs to do to give you that kind of power in your life. And if you have the Holy Ghost, whether you think you do or not, you've got that kind of power in your life. You need to understand that power. You need to understand that kind of authority that God has placed in you. Amen. The creator of the universe put inside of you his power. It's not your power, it's his.
Amen.
Mark 16, verse 17, and these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. And that is why we must do as the apostle Paul said in Ephesians 6, and put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We understand from Scripture that the child of God is not supposed to what you may consider lose in life. In 2 Corinthians 2, it says, now thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ. Amen. If you're a child of God, you shouldn't be getting defeated by the devil.
That's right.
Come on. Amen. He's given you the power to overcome. Amen. And he said, I will help you overcome.
Yep.
Amen. When you don't think that you can stand, just stand.
Right.
And see the salvation of the Lord. Amen. Amen. When you don't feel like you can go another step, then you just lift your hands to your Creator. And the Lord will intervene on your behalf. Amen. But there is victory, and only victory, in the future for a Christian.
Yes.
Amen. You should never be defeated by the devil.
Yes.
Amen. Because there is greater power given unto you.
Yeah.
Remember, if the scripture stands upon the premise that you and I are going to fight.
Yeah.
Amen. It's important today that you understand this. Amen. That it's not just a matter of just coming to church and sitting on a pew.
Right.
But it's understanding the power that God has placed in your life.
Right.
Amen. And the power to overcome the devil.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Praise God.
Amen. Amen. You know, in the mind of God, you're a winner.
Yes. Right.
In the mind of God,
yep,
you're a winner.
Yep.
You're not defeated.
Amen.
God didn't do all this so that you would finish out your days defeated by the devil.
That's right.
He didn't come and robe himself in flesh, live 33 and a half years among fallen man, die, give his life, rise from the dead, ascend into heaven so that you can live your life defeated.
Amen.
God wants to give you some victory today.
Yes.
He wants to give you some power. He wants you to understand the power of what he is wanting to give you. Amen. He's wanting to anoint you.
Yeah.
As Jesus was anointed with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. 1 John 2 tells us that ye have an unction from the Holy One, and you know all things. 2 Corinthians 1 and 21, now he which establishes us with you in Christ hath anointed us is God. He's the one that's anointed you. He's the one that is wanting to do something great in your life.
Yes.
But here's the thing. We have got to do our part. God's not going to do it all for you.
That's right.
Right.
Amen.
God doesn't want robots.
Right.
He doesn't want people that are just made to do something. He could have created a nation. He could have created a people that were made, that were just robots, didn't have free choice, didn't have free will, and just couldn't do anything other than what he made them to do. But that wouldn't be love. That wouldn't be a reflection of love and our stance against sin and saying, I'm not going to follow after sin. And that would take all responsibility off of us to stand against the wiles of the devil.
Right.
Because then we can just say, Lord, if the wiles of the devil has come upon me, it's because you haven't protected me. It's because you haven't kept me from the wiles of the devil. Because it takes all responsibility off of us. But God is wanting us to wake up today and understand that it is our responsibility.
Amen.
He will give you the power to overcome. He will give you power for victory in your life. He will do it. But you have got to come to yourself and say, I'm tired of allowing the devil to run me over. I'm tired of allowing the devil to come against me and destroy me and cause havoc in my family and cause havoc. Amen. I understand. I recognize what the devil is trying to do in my life and in my family's life. And I'm going to stand against it. And I'm going to pray against it. I'm going to fast against it. I'm going to be active. And I'm going to engage the enemy, and I'm going to destroy the enemy.
Amen.
Amen. We've got to submit ourselves to God. The Bible says, submit yourself therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you.
Right.
Amen. Nothing will change in your circumstances until you change.
Amen.
God's not going to change your circumstances if you're not willing to engage in change.
That's right.
God's not going to force you. You have to decide to be the man of God or the woman of God that you're destined to be. You have to decide to discipline yourself to the Word of God, to prayer and to fasting.
Right, right.
If you don't like the circumstances that you're dealing with in your life, then I ask you this question: what are you going to do about it?
That's right.
Amen. If you don't remember anything else that I say today, I want you to remember this. What are you going to do about the negative circumstances in your life? Are you just going to accept it and live out the remainder of your days struggling with the same things you've always struggled with? Or are you going to take a stand against and say, enough is enough? I'm tired of this. I'm tired of struggling with this. I'm going to get victory. I'm going to do whatever I need to do. And I promise you that if you will just do what you need to do,
yes,
just do your little action. Yeah, you may not can overcome the devil by yourself, but you just do your little bit of action, and the Lord will meet your
Amen.
Action with His action.
That's right.
Amen. The Lord will meet your little response with His big response, and will overcome the enemy.
Yes.
Amen. All Moses had to do was stretch his rod out over the sea. Moses didn't bring them deliverance.
Right.
Moses didn't bring them deliverance. All he had to do was obey the word of the Lord. The Lord said, stretch your rod out over the sea. And when Moses did his little action, the Lord did his.
Yes.
And moved the waters back and dried up the ground so that over 600,000 people could walk across on dry ground.
Amen.
Amen.
And then Moses followed up that action with another action. The Lord said, stretch your rod back over the sea. And when he did, that dry ground becomes muddy. And Moses, or Pharaoh's chariots and footmen, they get stuck in the mud. And next thing you know, the waters come crashing down over them again. Amen. I'm talking about, do you want victory in your life? Amen. The enemy that you see today, do you not want to see them ever again? Then you need to obey the word of the Lord. Amen. Even no matter how trivial it may seem, that God is still what he's telling you to do. You need to obey him. Amen. And the Lord will match your little action with his.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All throughout the scripture it's like that.
Yeah.
The prophet goes to the widow woman who's getting ready to die, her and her son, and says, bake me a cake first. Bake me a cake first. What? I've only got a little bit of oil in my cruise. Got a little bit of flour. My plan was to just bake a cake. Me and my son are going to eat this last meal, the last supper, and we're going to die. But she obeyed the word of the Lord. And she made the prophet a cake first. And the Bible says that her and her family, they went on throughout that entire famine with oil in their cruse and flour in their meal.
Right.
They didn't starve to death. She responded to the word of the Lord, and then God responded to that.
Amen.
What I'm telling you today, and I'm preaching to you this morning, and I'm coming to a close, is that you're not going to get victory over that problem by not doing anything.
That's right.
You're not going to get victory over that problem by doing nothing. By thinking that, oh, I can hide my head in the sand and pretend like it's not there. You still got a problem.
Yes.
You still got an issue. You're not fixing it. You're not getting rid of it. But the Lord is wanting something to rise up in your spirit today that says, enough is enough. get fed up with it. And say, you know what? Today is going to be my day of change. I'm never going back to what I used to be. I'm never doing that again. Because the Lord, and when, whatever the Lord asks you to do, if he asks you to come to this altar and lift your hands and to repent, do it. And the Lord will match your little action, your little insignificant action, with his major action that will deliver your life,
yes.
That will give you victory, that will give you power. But if you want your circumstances to change, you have got to be willing to change.
That's right.
Pastor Ott has always said, and he's, I've heard his sayings for 35 years, 36 years. But one of the sayings that he has always said, that if you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always gotten. In other words, that if you never make up your mind to change,
that's
then
right.
You are never going to change.
Amen.
If you don't make up your mind to say, you know what, I'm tired of it. I'm not putting up with this stuff anymore. I'm going to engage the devil. I'm going to engage this problem.
Yeah.
And I'm going to fight against it. How do you engage? By prayer, by fasting. By just simply existing, you're not engaging the enemy.
Right.
You know how you overcome addiction and overcome problems in your life? You engage the enemy.
Yeah.
By prayer and fasting. By prayer and fasting. Read the word of God. But by prayer and fasting, that's how you break chains. That's how things get broken in your life. That's how you never go back to things. Amen. By prayer and fasting, by engaging the enemy, by saying, I'm not going to just sit and just keep going through this, but I've had enough. I'm sick and tired of it, and I'm going to engage the enemy in faith. I'm going to pray against them. I'm going to pray. I'm going to recognize what my problem is, and I'm going to pray against it, and I'm going to fast against it until the Lord breaks and does his mighty work in my life.
Amen.
I'm not going to stop until the Lord delivers me, until the Lord changes me, I will not let go until he blesses me.
Amen.
Jacob was determined. He said, I'm not going to go back to my daddy's house the same way that I left. I want to be changed. And I will not let go until you bless me, until you change me, until there is a pronouncement of change over my life.
Amen.
Amen. I will hang on. I will keep moving forward. I will keep doing what I'm doing. I'm going to keep living for the Lord. I'm going to keep praying. And I'm going to keep fasting. I'm not going to give up until that change happens in my life. I'm going to keep repenting. I'm going to keep getting close to the Lord. I'm going to keep denying my flesh until that change happens. Until the Lord meets my little response with his big response that will cause direct and cause victory in my life.
Amen.
Can we stand this morning? You've got to make up your mind when enough is enough.
Amen.
You've got to make up your mind when enough is enough that I'm sick and tired of going through this. Jeremiah and I were working with a young man the other day. And he told me he wanted to go take a break, a smoke break. I said, what you doing, smoke? That stuff's going to kill you. That stuff's going to wrap you up in addiction, and it's going to kill you. It's going to kill your life. What are you doing? He said, I've tried to get free from it. And I just can't get free. I said, where's your cigarettes? He said, I just bought a new pack in Newport.
They're in the truck. I said, go get them. He said, John, I paid $8 for those cigarettes. I said, do you want to be free? I said, because you will destroy those cigarettes. And then Jeremiah and I will lay hands on you. We'll pray for you. And the Lord will deliver you from that addiction.
Yeah.
But you've got to be willing to destroy those cigarettes.
That's right.
To get rid of them. John, let me think about it. Let me think of it. He comes back in there. What was it, Jeremiah? About 10 minutes later. Comes back in there. Had that pack of cigarettes in his hand. There was a few missing in there. And I said, where are they all at? It ain't going to work if you're holding back, son. He said, I already smoked them. I said, the Lord knows your heart. If you're hiding some, the Lord ain't going to deliver you from it. If you're sincere and you want to be delivered, the Lord will deliver you.
Amen.
If you're willing to get rid of it, if you're willing to make that decision, that choice, to say, I'm going to engage this addiction and I'm going to get rid of it. Yeah. I'm not going to put up with it anymore.
Yeah.
He told me that was all he had. I said, okay. I said, tear him up. He tore him up. $8 in the trash.
Yeah.
I said, that's the best $8 you've ever spent or thrown away. That's the best $8 you've ever just tore up and threw in the trash. Amen. And then we prayed over him. I mean, I don't know. I told him, I said, brother, I felt the Holy Ghost when we were praying. I said, brother, the Lord has delivered you. I said, but the devil's going to come back and he's going to try to tempt you again. And he's going to try to lure you back in. You hang around with people that are smoking, then you're going to be tempted to go back in that direction. And I said, and if you ever go back in that direction, it's going to be harder for you to be delivered the next time. But the Lord has acted upon your action of faith, your little action of faith, and he has delivered you from these cigarettes. Now you need to keep progressing, and you need to abstain from people that are smoking and that are carousing and doing all those kinds of things, because that puts you back in that mindset to go back to what God has delivered you from.
That's right.
Amen. It's not just enough for God to just deliver you, but you have got to do your part and do your action to stay away from the venues and stay away from the people.
Yeah.
And the areas and the atmospheres.
Yeah.
That causes those temptations to come back at you. Amen. You've got to do your part. You can't say, well, the Lord delivered me. So I'm going to test the Lord to see if he really delivered me. And I'm going to go back and I'm going to go smell. Everybody's smoking cigarettes. I'm going to open their face. And if I don't have that urge anymore, then the Lord has delivered me. You're a fool. You're a fool to do that. You're tempting the Lord.
Yeah.
Amen. You need to have faith that the Lord has done what he has said that he has done.
Yeah.
Amen. And you need to stay. You need to do your part and stay away. Don't give an open door for the devil to come back in your life and to enslave you once again.
Right.
Yeah.
Amen. Just because you go back to a sin does not mean that God has not originally delivered you from that. Amen. But you have that choice. He didn't create you to be a robot, but he created you with a choice to make up your mind that enough is enough. And I'm going to live for Jesus. I'm going to do the right thing. I'm going to stay away from people that are influencing me in bad ways.
Amen.
I asked Jeremiah. I said, how's he doing? Has he picked him up again? He said, I don't know, but he went back to hanging out with this crowd. People smoking, people doing all kinds of foolish things. The Lord did a work for him that day. The Lord responded to his faith. His faith was the action of tearing up those cigarettes. That was a big deal for him. He had to think about it for about 10 minutes before he actually made up his mind that he was tired of dealing with this problem. He said, I've tried to get free. He said, I used to do marijuana. And I was able to, the Lord helped me with that. And I got free of that. But these cigarettes was another beast. I couldn't break free from it. Amen. You have got to make up your mind today that you want to be delivered, that you want victory. And then you've got to engage the enemy. You've got to say, you know what? I'm breaking this stuff. I'm getting rid of this stuff. And I'm never going back. I'm breaking those communications with those that lead me in a bad direction. I'm abstaining from the appearance of evil.
Yeah.
If it even looks bad, I'm going to stay away from it.
That's right.
Because I'm going to protect myself and I'm going to make it do a positive action here. And the Lord is going to give me grace. And the Lord is going to do his big action of giving me deliverance.
Amen.
Amen. Let's lift our hands towards heaven right now. Jesus. Lord, I thank you, Jesus. God, I thank you for your spirit. These altars are open today if you want to come and pray. You want to stay where you're at? Stay where you're at. Amen. But talk to the Lord right now. God is here. Amen. Whatever the Lord tells you to do, you need to do it. You need to respond to his word. You need to respond to him this morning. Amen. I believe that the Lord really gave me this word to help you today to understand that you don't have to just be on the defensive all the time. But he's given you some power to where you can overcome addiction and overcome problems in your life. You can overcome circumstances. You can overcome the attacks of the devil. You can be victorious this morning. Amen. But you've got to respond to the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Amen. If you've been having an onslaught on your family, you need to pray against the devil. Pray against that onslaught. Pray against carnality. Amen. You need to put carnality on the cross and say, I'm not going in that direction anymore. I'm going to lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset me. And I'm going to run with patience the race that is set before me. Jesus, Lord, I love you today. God, I love you today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord is here right now. Respond to him right now. Jesus, I thank you for it today. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, I worship you. God, give my brothers victory, God. Let there be power, Lord. God, in their lives, in Jesus' name, touch them, Lord. God, fill them with the Holy Ghost.
Thank you,
Jesus, we thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. God, touch Brendan and Israel, Lord. God Almighty, give them victory, Lord. Power with you, Lord. God, help them, Lord, to come to a realization. The Lord.